We are here today to celebrate the amazing life of Gary Wolfe. Gary was a man of deep faith, sincere hope, and gracious love. His love for Rebecca, his love for his family and friends, showed through in his generous and gracious spirit, and the way he gave himself to others and indeed to the world. During the last few days, I've had many conversations about Gary among the members and friends of First Community Church. As you might imagine, there's sort of a common theme that runs through these conversations. One person said to me, "Gary was always kind to me," and she said it with tears in her eyes. Another person said to me over lunch when talking about Gary that if you're having a bad day, a brief encounter with Gary, for 30 seconds even, could completely turn your day around. Another said he was always, always upbeat, happy, and encouraging. In my personal experience with Gary, he was especially gracious. A pat on the back and a attaboy, keep doing what you're doing because you're good at it, felt like a gift from heaven. Simple words for sure, but they were authentic and real, spoken from his heart. I met this week with the volunteers who manage our store, the Trading Post, down at First Community South. You know the Trading Post, their motto is shop and make a difference. Most of you know that Rebecca managed the store for many, many years, transforming it, and setting it up for the great success they're experiencing now. It's a real joy to see the work that they do. They shared their end of the year report with me yesterday as we reviewed all the great work they did, the mission projects that they supported here and around the world. And they said, be sure and look at the tribute to Gary. It's a two-page tribute in the middle of their very long report. Beautiful words are spoken about him. One whole page of it, though, is single-spaced, bulleted list of all the projects he did at the Trading Post. I had to take a nap after I read this. It's incredible to think of the great work he did in the last 15 years here or so here at First Community Church. What a blessing he has been to so many. And so, yes, we will indeed celebrate the great and amazing life of Gary Wolfe. We're also here to grieve. Death always brings a sense of loss. Gary's life was long and well-lived, but there will be an empty chair at the table today. And that empty chair in many ways represents the empty space in our heart, one where sadness and sorrow will reside. Please know in this space you are free to pour out your hearts, to feel your sorrow, to name your grief. The prize-winning author and novelist, Madeline L'Engle, was asked following the death of her husband of 44 years, what helped you the most? She replied, rhetorically asking the same question, what helped me the most were the friends who came with few words, who said, I love you, and held me tightly in their arms. Come on this day, with few words and open arms, ready to share in the grief that is real in this place. We're also here to listen for the voice of God. God speaks in many ways, through scripture, prayer, music, even the words of a friend can be delivered as though they're from heaven itself. On this day, listen carefully, and you may hear that voice, that sacred and holy voice, in a new and surprising way. Finally, we are also here to remember Jesus Christ, crucified, buried, and resurrected. We're here to remember that the last word of the Bible is the best word of the Bible, that God loves us and knows us and calls us by name, that we will not be left behind, we will not be forgotten, we will be gathered up finally in that one great, holy, and amazing moment when all of God's children are reunited again in the arms of heaven's good and gracious love. Yes, on this day, we will celebrate this great man and his great love. Amen.
Thank you. In this very room, there's quite enough love for one like me. And in this very room, there's quite enough joy for one like me. And there's quite enough hope and quite enough power to chase away any gloom. For Jesus, Lord Jesus, is in this very
Before we walked in, I invited the whole family to take a few deep breaths together, and I want to extend that to everyone present this day, to take a deep breath. When we do that, it helps us to be a little bit more present in this space with one another and with our God. And let's pray together. Holy God, you said that where two or three are gathered, you are in our midst, so we know that your Spirit is with us in this place. So God, help us to feel it, reminding us of your presence with us through days like this one. May we feel it as a comfort and a reminder that you are with us through the toughest of days, just as you are powerfully present in Gary's life, you are present here as we celebrate him. You are in the words we share, the songs we hear and sing, the prayers we pray, and the very breath we breathe. Every day, but especially on this day, when we come together to celebrate the life of one of your blessed children, we know that we need you guiding us in how we relate to one another. So we ask you this day, O God, to help us to give as we would receive, to hear as we would choose to be heard, to speak as we would choose to be spoken to, and to forgive as we would choose to be forgiven. Remind us of those things on the days when grief fills our hearts. God, remind us of those things every day, for we do tend to forget. We take this time today to breathe in your Holy Spirit, to be present in this space with you and each other, to gather and truly celebrate Gary's life. Surround us, O God. We pray in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. Jodi, Kim, and Karla are about to come up here today to share moments and memories of Gary's very full and vibrant life. We cannot ever come close to summarizing a life, but we can capture the essence and spirit of one. I am always amazed how storytelling seems to come naturally, especially while holding vigil around a bedside, as you all have been. It's not just a way to pass the time. It's one of the most holy experiences that we could ever share with one another, for it connects the lives and the stories of the ones that we love to the great story of all of God's children. It connects us through time and space. It brings healing into the lonely quiet. It brings smiles that are healing balm to weary souls. Stories of a life are stories of the kind of love that God dreams for us. Jodi, Kim, and Karla, will you please come up?
Hi, some of you may not know us. I'm Kim, Gary's oldest daughter. This is Karla, the middle daughter, and Jodi, the youngest. It's hard not to love our dad. As I was sitting next to his bedside in the hospital, he said to me, "You can ask me anything." I thought for a moment, and then trying to keep it light, I said, "Okay, here's a question for you. Am I your favorite daughter?" He looked at me, smiled, and said, "Yes." I looked back at him, smiled, and said, "You would answer yes if Karla or Jodi asked you that same question." He looked at me, smiled, and shook his head. Also, while in the hospital, there was a day a friend from church came to visit, and the first thing Dad said to this gentleman as he stepped up to his bedside was, "Thank you for being my friend." It brought tears to my eyes. To meet our dad was to love our dad. He would make you feel like you were the most important person in the world. When talking to him, he genuinely cared to listen to you, ask questions, and really get to know the person you are inside and out. He never met a stranger. Dad loved when the entire family could get together. Before all the grandkids grew up and everyone's occupations got in the way, we would always celebrate our family Christmas on Christmas Eve. It was so much fun. We would gather and make an entire evening of it, and usually into the wee hours of the morning. There would be a full dinner spread, church, and then the opening of the presents, which took hours. He was in his glory, always taking pictures or videos. We are so fortunate he did that. In his later years, he spent hours upon hours taking all the photos from not only all the great times we spent together as a family, but also our individual lives. He put them into flash drives for each of us and each of the grandkids. There are pictures of my grandparents, my great-grandparents, and the childhood and growing up of both him and Rebecca. So special. These are priceless memories that I will cherish for the rest of my life. Dad and his girls, he was definitely a girl dad. We are blessed to have one last trip together, the five of us. Mom, Dad, and the three girls. We went out to Las Vegas in November of 2022 and had a blast. He was so proud to be with his girls. We laughed, we ate, and we even got him to gamble a bit. He loved the Rat Pack back in the day, Dean Martin, Frank Sinatra, and Sammy Davis Jr. We went to see the Rat Pack impersonators, and he loved it. I remember sitting next to him at a slot machine and how excited he was when he got a bonus on the machine. He turned his $20 into $200. He was done for the trip. He had made his fortune. He has been a great role model for our children, his grandchildren. There were many times one of my children would ask me a question. I would say, let me get Grandpa's input. I'm sure he'll have an answer or offer some advice.
He has always been my champion and my rock. It didn't matter what the circumstances were. He was there for me, giving me words of encouragement or simply a shoulder to cry on. I can't express how much I miss him. I am one of the luckiest girls in the world to be able to call him Dad.
Okay. As she said, I'm Karla. I'm the middle daughter. We do want to thank everyone for coming today and taking time out of their day to pay tribute to Dad. In true Gare Bear form, he's probably looking down from heaven with, oh my gosh, look how many people are here. He would be surprised, but we're not. Anyone that knew Dad, he was a friend. There was never a stranger with him. The first time you would meet Dad, he would usually open with a, what do you do for a living? Which was quickly followed by Gary's 50 questions. If you were a teacher, it would be, where do you teach? What grade do you teach? Where did you go to school? Where did you grow up? By the end of the conversation, he knew everything about you and would recall that information, whether he saw you again 2 days later, 2 weeks later, or 2 years later. He would quickly open with a, how is your class this year? He was a very structured, organized, routine-following dad. I'm not sure everyone knew that. Every morning started the same. He would get up very early, retired or not, take his shower, get dressed, shoes and all, I may add, start the coffee, get the paper, turn the TV on, and sit down to enjoy his morning bowl of Cheerios and coffee. He somehow was managing always to get the right ratio of milk to Cheerios and space that out throughout the newspaper right up until the last page, all while watching the news on TV. He was a multitasker. Dad loved cars, always had the newest thing out there. Most people just drove their new car home and enjoyed it. Not Dad. He needed a few Gary upgrades before he could take it home. It could start with a radar detector, a CD back in the day, possibly a whip antenna, a few car mats, and some mud flaps. We always got a kick out of that, but he always had to put his little Gary gadgets in there, for sure. He always told us when buying a new car, make sure you get that factory matched car stick to touch up any chips on the hood you may get. We loved all those quirky things about Dad and so many more. What I missed the most is the I love yous at the end of every call, at the end of every visit. We'll miss you so much, Dan. You were the best. We love you.
So I'm Jodi. I'm the youngest. So when I sat down to write this, I was like, okay, I gotta figure out a way to get through this, so I'm just gonna start late. And hope that I make it. So I wanted to start off by talking about what I felt like Dad might most well be known for, which were like, you know, some of his three loves. First was his love for cars, which Karla already alluded to. I think he had, my mom said 45 over his 88 years of living, to be exact. He never spent more than a few years in any one car, and then was quickly on the hunt for the next. He also was always more than happy to help others on their quest for new vehicles and worked tirelessly to get them what he felt was the best deal. He successfully passed on his love for new vehicles to my oldest son, Ashton, saving every new issue of Car and Driver and Motor Trend to share with him. Second, his love for electronics. Many people also note that my father was an electronics aficionado, Gadget Gary, always on the hunt for better quality, higher resolution, more pixels, faster processing. I probably didn't even get some of this terminology right because I didn't get that gene from him. So, Dad knew it all. Our good friend Robbie Baker said it best when he was remembering my father. He said, Gary is probably up in heaven right now, providing consultation to St. Peter about upgrading the electronics in heaven. And I'm sure he is. It's like that TV is definitely too small. 5G is coming, so whatever. And then during his last weeks in the hospital, when he had been moved to comfort care, he was quick to request that the bed and TV remotes be placed in his hands, like at all times, which felt so fitting for a guy whose longstanding hobby involved everything Best Buy had to offer. So I remember I was like, where's the remotes? And they were like in his grip, like this. I was like, okay, Dad, all right, I'll make sure you have them. Okay, and his third love. This is my favorite part to talk about. His love for ice cream. So fortunately or unfortunately, this one passion he wholeheartedly passed down to just about every member of his family. We don't have enough time to recount all the memories that we have of our dad as it relates to his love for ice cream. But when it came to ice cream, he was always prepared with at least 4 half gallons on hand at all times, unless Meyer was having a sale where it was like $2.99, and so then he had to buy like 11. And I'm like, Dad, what are you guys gonna do with all these half gallons? Because they could only eat ice cream on Thursdays. That was their rule. So I was like, I don't understand. But you know, so if we ran out of ice cream, we would go to Grandma and Grandpa's because they for sure had ice cream. My dad was also very specific about how he liked it. So it had to be ice cold and hard, which meant when you bought it from the store, you had to go get it from the back of the freezer. You know what I mean? Because the front might be mushy. It had to be vanilla. So French vanilla, not vanilla bean, right?
True.
Chocolate syrup or hot fudge. And finally, no whipped cream, no cherry, and definitely no nuts. If you want to ask any member of our family about my dad and nuts on his ice cream, it'll be a good time. They can tell you all about it. But in my father's very gracious way, he accepted what we were able to find for him at the hospital as he asked for ice cream many times throughout his long hospitalization. And I feel like I was constantly saying, do you want some ice cream, Dad? Do you want some ice cream? And like one time he asked for it and I went down to get him chocolate syrup and the cafeteria was closed and I was frantically looking around, how can I get in? How can I get in? And I found a janitor. I'm like, can you let me in? My dad needs chocolate syrup for his ice cream. So, but as particular as he was about his ice cream, he was also equally selfless. While it was always his job to scoop the ice cream at home, he made sure everyone had what they needed and the way they liked it before taking care of his own. This selflessness extended well beyond scooping ice cream, though, as my dad was selfless in so many ways, always wanting the light to shine on others before himself. Upon reflection, I realized that I perhaps took for granted how selfless my dad actually was. Every conversation with my father started out with some version of, like my sister said, well, how was your day? What's on your agenda today? How are you doing? He was never one to spend much time talking about himself. He always wanted to know more about you. Now, I had always known my dad liked cars, electronics, and ice cream, but I also felt like I got to know a more intimate side of him over the past few years as he aged. I can remember asking my dad a few years ago about his bucket list, and I thought that would be kind of a fun conversation. I remember being struck by his answer as he shared very contently that he felt that he had experienced so many wonderful things in his life he couldn't think of anything that felt important enough to comment on. Well, I remember feeling a little disappointed at the time. I now look at this conversation very differently. My dad was communicating something very simple and beautiful. This was a man who lived a full life, and at the end, he wanted for nothing more than time with his important people, which, of course, has always been his family. So my father's commitment to and love for his family has been a hallmark of his life. His words still ring in my head. I just like it when our whole family is able to spend time together. While this became more challenging over the years, my father never stopped asking for it and treasured each and every opportunity he got. Our family had countless memories together that were created out of my parents' desire for family time when they decided to purchase a timeshare in Florida with enough room and opportunity for the whole family to gather on a regular basis. We have so many good memories from being together in Florida. I know that that was so important to him. This was his happy place, basking in the warm Florida sunshine with his family close by, and of course, not too far from Disney, which was one of his all-time favorite places to visit. My mom said it made him feel like he was a kid again. As I shared the news of my father's passing with others that had known him, I was struck by the common themes that seemed to emerge. Almost everyone commented on his pleasant demeanor. always smiling, always happy to see you, always demonstrating how much he cared about whoever he was talking to in that moment. In this age of constant distraction, where technology is trying to grab our attention with beeps and tweets and alerts, I realized my dad was the master at just being present and showing you that he genuinely cared. When you were with him, you knew he cared about you and whatever you had to say. Even in the last weeks of his life, my father's ability to be truly present with others shone through in how he treated those that provided care for him while in the hospital. It didn't matter if you were the janitor, the PCA, a nurse, a doctor. He was always ready with a smile and then usually a compliment, letting people know that they did a great job. Our dad, the ultimate complimenter. I love this about him. As I have watched people light up as he would bring a ray of sunshine into their lives. I wanted to share a few recent examples of this. During his first admission to the hospital, before he had his shoulder surgery, there was a PCA that cared for him for a few days in a row. I can still remember the smile on her face every time she walked in the door to see him, which at first I thought was just a part of her sunny personality. It wasn't until a few days later that I realized the special bond she had built with my dad in a short time. This bond ultimately brought tears to her eyes as our dad was talking about memories of his family and what the family meant to him. It was like my father had seen her, and she knew that. And I could then understand very clearly that my father had touched her in a very special way. I also remember just 1 week before his passing, just like 7 days, my dad, he was in hospice care at this time. My dad's reaction to the daily iPad rounding with his hospice physician. So apparently now they like do iPad rounding, which was new to me. But the nurse walks in with an iPad and the doctor is on the screen and she puts the iPad in front of my dad's face. And he immediately, his face lit up. He put on a smile and he looked at the doctor and said, "Well, how are you today?" I'm like, "Really? You're in hospice, Dad. Like, how are you doing?" And you could tell the doctor was kind of like taken aback and quietly kind of like chuckled and said, "Well, I'm good. How are you doing?" That was our dad. Even in his final days of life here on Earth, where he lay helpless in a hospital bed for more days than I care to count, stripped of his independence and facing the reality of his own death, our father could still make you feel seen. It's my sincere belief that he is very busy in heaven right now, making a lot of people feel seen, that he hasn't actually seen in a long time, including our beloved dog, Cisco, whom my father similarly adored. I believe he is spending time with those he has loved and lost, making those around him feel that they are the most important thing in the universe at that moment, and eating ice cream while watching some sort of football game on the biggest TV screen heaven has to offer. And I'm quite sure that in heaven, the Browns finally win the Super Bowl for him. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Mark Murphy. On January 13th, my wife and I, Tammy, and I had the opportunity to visit Gary and Rebecca when Gary was at Ross Heart Hospital. And it was a precious time that we could be together. And I'm going to sing the song that Gary asked me to sing. It is kind of made popular by the artist Mercy Me. It's called "I Can Only Imagine." And we played this song for Gary while he was laying there. And he smiled, and there were tears, and you could just tell he was truly imagining. But as I was reflecting on the words that were shared here this morning, and Gary's no longer imagining anything, he's truly experiencing worshiping with Jesus and basking in all that heaven has to offer. I'm just going to invite you, as Janelle and I do the song meditation, you're welcome to sing along if you know it. That would probably help me. So. I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine.
The scripture that was chosen for today comes from the book of Isaiah, chapter 25, verses 7 through 9. Hear these words of comfort and hope. And God will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the covering that is spread over all nations. God will swallow up death forever. Then God will wipe away the tears from all faces and will take away the disgrace of God's people from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, "See, this is our God, for whom we have waited, so that God might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in God's salvation." May God bless us in the hearing of these holy words of Scripture this day. Gary and Rebecca are two people with deep faith that I admire immensely. From the moment that they introduced themselves to me until this very moment now, my own relationship with God has been opened wider and grown deeper because of them. And I know that I am not the only one, for we hear stories all the time. But that is why being asked to speak a word on this day is such a great honor and also has been such a great challenge. That blinking cursor on the computer screen that Pastor Glenn talks about quite often has been poking at me for days now. The best thing that you can do is look somewhere else. So I would. I would look up from my screen, and there I would see this stole hanging on the ladder in my office. A gift from Rebecca many, many months ago now, made by faithful women all the way across the world. It has donned my neck for almost every single memorial service since, and I knew that I would be wrapped in it again on this day. So then I would leave my computer completely and go sit on the couch in my office, only to look down and see the artfully and meticulously painted prayer stones perfectly laid out in a dish on the coffee table, with phrases like, "God is with you, let your light shine," and my personal favorite that no one has taken yet, "Pocket hug." Another gift to me from the Wolfes. They're there so people who come in for care and counsel can take something with them for assurance. So naturally, my mind drifted to all those people that those stones, and by proxy, Gary and Rebecca, had blessed so far. There was the 4-year-old who wandered in last summer with her mom and grandma as she went on a tour of the preschool. She was so nervous to start at a new school and moving across the country. So of course, she picked out the pink one, her favorite color. I remembered the grieving widow whose favorite hymn lyrics just so happened to be painted on one of those stones, later to be used as the opening hymn for her husband's memorial service. I remembered the stones I found sitting on the couch in the quiet hospital room from two daughters who had left them with mom, who was sleeping in the bed while they went down to the cafeteria. So I had to return to my desk and to the blinking cursor with a smile on my face, and I looked left and I saw the prayer book that I bought with the Barnes & Noble gift card that Gary and Rebecca gave me last October for Pastor Appreciation Week, which is a real thing. And it is no longer a surprise to me that Gary and Rebecca remember each year when October rolls around. So I decided to leave my office altogether because it wasn't going so well. I took my blinking cursor home with me, so I gathered up my things and I made my trek across the church parking lot, giving a nod over to the annex and the trading post, Gary and Rebecca's second home. And then I giggled as I remembered the story that you shared with me. I had asked, "When did you know that Gary was the one for you?" She said, "I knew he was the one when I saw him trekking across the church parking lot with the projector I asked him to bring in from my car." That was the church in Akron, I think, and that was 47 years ago. I have heard it said, and I truly believe, that you cannot escape the love of God. And that is how I know that the love that Gary and Rebecca share with the world and each of us and with each other is the type of love that comes directly from God. because you can't escape it. It's all around you, and you can't look away no matter how hard you try. The love and care those two offer and offered the world is so natural. Loving and caring for other people is as natural as breathing to them, and I am certain that you both would say that you have worked at it, faithfully following in the footsteps of Jesus, immersed in the stories of Scripture, looking for guidance and wisdom on how to love even better. But I'm convinced that fiercely loving is second nature, maybe even first nature. Fierce love is actually how Gary was described. I wrote all of them down. Alongside the words selfless, gentle soul, many you've heard today, outgoing, a friend to all, always smiling, always happy to see you, truly interested in knowing you, funny, making everyone else shine around him. Alongside all of that, buried on the page, actually, I had written the words weeks ago, fiercely loved. That stuck out to me. Because the words we all use to describe Gary, gentle, kind, selfless, his smile even, or just the way he would so gently take your hand to pray, those words and the word fierce feel like opposites to me. There's an intensity behind that word that just isn't found in the others. When we got together to plan this service, Rebecca flipped open her rather tattered, clearly loved Bible to the scripture that she chose for today. And I have to say, it surprised me. I was kind of expecting a psalm, maybe not one that we hear all the time, but one that through your study and contemplation had blessed you in some way with all the waiting and the holding vigil. Or I even thought that she would choose a gospel story, a longer story that would make all of us pause and listen, consider the tender love of God on glorious display through the actions of Jesus. So I was surprised when she began to read from the prophet Isaiah, this one with big, powerful words like destroy and swallow up, disgrace and wipe away, waited and waited, salvation. Why this one? I asked her. Why is this the scripture that you were drawn to? She said, well, I love that. I believe that. Death will be swallowed up forever, that the shroud, the veil, will be destroyed, allowing us to discover the everlasting love of God. It points us to God. Fierce love calls for fierce words sometimes. Fierce love calls for fierce words sometimes. Not just hope, but audacious hope. Not just peace, but boundless peace. Not just grace, but reckless grace. God will, it says, God will destroy the shroud that covers us, that hides us from love. God will swallow up death forever. God will wipe away the tears from all faces. God will take away the disgrace from God's people. It will be said, this is our God for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice. And maybe you're struggling to believe that on a day like this. We've probably all questioned it at some point. But that is why we gather. That is why we come together in grief and in love to hear it said, proclaimed fiercely, that life wins, love wins. Death does not have the final word. Thanks be to God who was, is, and will be. Thanks be to love that was, is, and forever will be. Amen.
Let us join together in a moment of prayer. God of love and life, though our hearts are broken and our spirits are filled with sorrow, we give you thanks for the gracious and joyous life of Gary Wolfe. We're grateful for the way his love will live on in those who knew him best. His wife, Rebecca, his children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, and his many friends spread out over nearly 9 decades of life. Thank you, God, for the joy that he brought to the life of his family and friends, for the love that was given through special occasions and warm smiles, through his passion for caring for his church, and his ongoing love for life. God, know that he will be missed greatly by all who knew him, especially his family. Their lives are better because they knew him, but they will miss his presence among them. On this day, we're also thankful for his service to the United States and his efforts as a member of the Hudson Police Force and as a volunteer firefighter. Gary's life was centered on service above self. And when he served, he gave his all, no matter the cause, small or large. Holy One, help us to see in Gary's life of service the call that is placed upon all of us to give ourselves to each other and to the world in the name of love. Gary was a student of the Bible, and he understood Jesus' clear teaching to care for the least of these, the hungry, the thirsty, the stranger, the sick, and the prisoner. But more than simply understanding this teaching, he lived it in practice. Now, merciful God, through our tears, give us a clear vision of your presence among us. In faith, help us to see the consolation you intend for all. In your mercy, grant us the unfailing guidance of your gracious love, both now and forevermore. We pray all these things in the name of the one who taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
I want to invite you to rise in body or in spirit this day. It is because of God's great mercy through Christ that we may be born again into a life full of hope. It is our faith that our loved ones move into the nearer, peaceful presence of God and abide with God and all the saints who have come before us. For death is not the ending, but the expansion of our lives. Jesus said, "Let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In God's house, there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? The place has been prepared. And now we commend to God with thanksgiving, Gary Wolfe, in the name of God, our Creator, Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, and the Holy Spirit who sustains us." Rebecca and the family would love if after the service you would come forward and create a bouquet of memorial flowers to take home with you. Vases will be provided. But first, as we leave from this space, I want to offer you a blessing. But before that, we always offer a charge. A charge is just a reminder of what your calling is during your time on earth. Your charge is always to love. Love fiercely, just as our God loves each and every one of us. And Gary has given us a wonderful example of how to do that. So go forth to love and serve, and as you do that, take with you this blessing. May God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May God look upon you with kindness and give you peace. Amen.